mitzvah Adonai, Elohim Melech HaOlam, Sher Kitchanu B'mitzvotav, Tzivanu B'Kitotek Batzitzit. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe,
who sanctified us with commandments,
commanded us with
requirements,
and commanded ourselves with tzitzit.
Amen.
At this time, we'll have BenYa'akov, BenYitzchak, and BenYaakov to sound the shofar as we give the blessing for the sounding of the shofar.
Baruch atah Adonai, Elohim Melech HaOlam, Asher Kidshanu B'Mitzvotav, Tzivanu
Shmo Kol HaShofar.
Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe,
who sanctified us with his commandments and commanded us to hear the sound of the shofar.
Amen.
Our Father, our King, we thank you today, Lord God. You are God of heaven and earth, God of all creation. You are El Elyon, the Most High God, El Gibor, the Mighty God, the Sufficient One, El Shaddai. Father, today you are Adon HaOlam. You are Lord of the universe. Today we ask you to be Adon HaShabbat, the Lord of the Sabbath over our lives, that we may enter into your perfect rest through Yeshua, the Messiah. And Father, we thank you today, Lord God, in that finished work. We declare your peace and your rest, not only to ourselves, but to our families, to our communities. Father, even over our businesses. Father, all that we possess, Lord God, our resources. And with all of our heart, soul, and strength, we will love you today. We will commit to love our neighbor as we love ourselves.
Amen.
And Father, we thank you today, Lord God, that even as we bring ourselves together, united as a kehilah, a congregation united for one purpose, to assemble together in perfect unity, to be echad, to be one. Jews and Gentiles alike worshiping our God and Messiah today. And Father, we thank you, Lord God, for protecting Israel. We thank you, Lord God, for guarding her, protecting her gates, her doorways, her entrances. We thank you for protecting her people, Father. We thank you, the nation that you have called holy. Father, all nations will emulate her and one day be like her. That, Father, Lord God, we can all go to Jerusalem together, all the nations, all the goyim will learn Torah and learn war no more. Father, we pray against violence, anti-Semitism, racism, and Father, Lord God, terrorism. We pray that it would stop in our days and that the reign of the Prince of Peace would not only reign over the world, but reign in our hearts today. We pray someone will accept Yeshua as Messiah today, that they will humble themselves to the footstool of Yeshua. Of our Messiah. And Father, we thank you today, Lord God. The plot of the enemy has failed. Father, your people prevail. And Father, we pray, Lord God, even for the grieving and loss of loved ones today, even one of our very own. We pray, Lord God, for the family of Stephen and us as his family spiritually. We pray, Lord God, that we'll remember him, Lord God, and remember that how faithful he was to the house of God. And may we always remember those who have passed on into glory. And Father, we just thank you for your
Lord.
Peace and your presence. Your power today to be revealed in and through us. B'Shem Yeshua. Amen.
Amen.
So as we always like to always remember that, like to ask the question if there's anyone who is here who's experienced the loss of a loved one. We've got Patty back there. Stephen Kelsey. When I got the news, I was very blown away. I told my my in-laws and my mother-in-law was just really shocked. That happened, and so we're going to give a cottage for him, and also Don was
my cousin Jimmy Racine.
Okay, it's cousin Jimmy.
And my brother Ruben's anniversary.
Okay, Yard Bates, which is memory for a loved one. Anyone here? I thought I saw a hand. No one. And I know some of you might remember Kathy. She had to go out of town this weekend. Her mom passed away, so also we'll be doing a cottage for her mom. And we always love to remember that Kaddish comes from the root word Kadosh, Let us always remember that God is holy. Let us be holy, for He is holy.
Amen.
And the fact that, for that reason, that He is the one who judges all of us, for He is the one who's created us. At this time, the Kaddish. Yit gadal v'yit kadash shamei rabba ben madi brachi rute v'yamlich malchute b'chaha yechon uv'yohom echon uchayid echon v'Yisrael b'ahagala b'ahagala uv'izman kariv v'imeru amein. Yehesh me'ratka mevorach, le'olam olome olmaya, yitbarach, yitbarach ve'yishtabach, ve'yipar ve'yroman ve'yinase, ve'yidhadar ve'yale ve'yidhalal, shmedi kudisha brichu, le'lemi kol berchata, be'shirahata, tush bechata, ve'nechemata, Dami Rambalma, Imeru Amen. Heishlama Rabba Mishamaya, Bechaim Aleinu Be'al Kol Yisrael, Imeru Amen. O Hosei Shalom Ben Ramah, Hu Yasei Shalom Aleinu, Be'al Kol Yisrael, Imeru. Amen. Glorified and sanctified be His great name in the world which is created according to His will. May He cause the reign of His kingdom in your lifetime and in your days, and the life of all the house of Israel, speedily, yes, soon. And let us all say, Amen. May His great name be blessed forever and forever eternally. Blessed and praised, glorified and exalted, extolled and honored, adored and lauded be the name of the Holy One. Blessed be He, who is high above, far above all blessings and hymns and praises and consolations which are spoken in this world. Let us say, Amen. May there be great peace from heaven and life for us and for all of Israel. And let us say, Amen. May, he who makes peace in the heavenly realms, may He make peace for us and for all of Israel. And let us all say, Amen. And words of a messianic encouragement: be not afraid of sudden terror, nor the storm that strikes the wicked. Do your scheming, it shall not succeed. Make your plan, it shall not prevail. For God is with us. Even in your old age will I be the same. When your hairs are gray, I will sustain you still. I have created you, and I will carry you. I will sustain you and save you. So let us gather our hearts together in unity and in God as we face towards Jerusalem, towards the east, and we give the words of the Shema.
Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Baruch Shem Kevod Malchuto Leolam Vaed.
Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. Blessed be His glorious name, to be saved forever and ever.
Ve'ahavta et Adonai Elohecha, bechol levavcha ubechol nefshecha, ubechol me'odecha. Ve'hayu hadevarim ha'ele, asher anochi mitzavecha, hayom alevavecha, ve'shinatam levanecha, ve'divartam aham, ve'shivtecha ha'bebeitecha, ubetecha ha'baderech, ubeshochmecha ubkumecha. Ukshartam leot hayedecha, vehayu letotafot beinenecha, ukhtatam al mezuzot beitecha, uvihisharecha. Amen.
And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. Let these words that I command you today be upon your heart. Teach them thoroughly to your children, and speak to them while you sit in your home, while you walk on the way, when you retire, and when you arise. Bind them as a sign upon your arm, and let them be frontless between your eyes, and write them on the doorposts of your house and upon your gates. Amen. Ve'ahavta le'racha kamocha, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Amen.
At this time, we shall take the Torah from the Aron HaKodesh, the Holy Ark, as we take it throughout the people, and I will give the blessing of Ein Kamocha, there is none like you.
Ein kamocha v'elohim Adonai v'ein kemasecha Malchut shecha Malchut kol olamim U'memshaltecha v'chol dor v'ador Adonai melech Adonai malach Adonai yimloch Le'olam va'ed Adonai oz le'amo yitein Adonai yivarech e'amo v'shalom Aharachami etivah v'rzoncha etzimon Tivne chomot Yerushalayim ki becha lebad batachnu melech el ram benisa adon olamim.
There is none like you, O Lord, among the gods that are worshipped, and there are no deeds like yours. Your kingdom is forever. You reign through all generations. The Lord reigns. The Lord will reign forever and ever. O Lord, give strength to your people. O Lord, bless your people with peace. Father of compassion, deal kindly with Zion, according to your will. Rebuild the walls of Jerusalem, for we trust in you alone, O King, revered and honored God, Master of the entire universe. Amen.
Vayehi b'tzoharon, vayomer Moshe, kuma Adonai, ve'afutzu oyvecha. וינוסו מסנך מפניך כי מציון תצא תורה כי מציון תצא תורה ודבר אדוני ירושלים ברוך שנתן תורה תורה ברוך שנתן תורה תורה Le'amo Yisrael b'kedushato.
And when the ark would travel, Moses would say, Arise, O Lord, and let your enemies be scattered, and let them flee from before your face. For from Zion will go forth the Torah, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. Blessed be he who gave the Torah to his people Israel in his holiness. Amen.
Baruch Hashem.
Baruch Hu Adonai Hamavarach.
Baruch Adonai Hamavarach Leolam Ba'ed.
Baruch Adonai Hamavarach Leolam Ba'ed.
Baruch Atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher Bachar Banu Mikol Hamim Ve'natan Lanu Et Torato. Baruch Atah Adonai Noten HaTorah. Amen.
Blessed the Lord, the Blessed One. Blessed is the Lord, the Blessed One for all eternity. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who chose us from all people and gave us the Torah. Blessed are you, O Lord, Giver of the Torah. Amen.
Well, Boker Tov and Shabbat Shalom to all that are here today.
Boker Tov, I'm so glad you're well. And for all of you beautiful faces that I see that are back that are well also, I feel your pain because I was after Shabbat. By Sunday morning, I had that little sinus drip, and I've been battling with it all week, but other than a little stuffiness, I feel good to be in the house of the Lord. I'm so glad you're here today. To all of you.
Well, as we like to ask, is there anyone who is here for the very first time? Or
I see a first-timer right there. So glad to have you with us. Anybody else? All right, the rest of you are all family. We do have some people that are sick that couldn't make it today, so let's keep them in prayer as we're doing that today. Praying for those that are sick in body, those that are here, and those that couldn't make it today. So we want to welcome our first-time guest and have her come up to the reading table to review the scroll today.
Yeah.
So come, and whoever invited her, Alessandra and David, do you want to come and join her today? Make it easier, because you're coming up alone, you know. I don't bite, though, I promise. Only when I'm hungry or hangry, yes. Your first name in the city you're from?
Rebecca Menifee.
Beautiful name, Rebecca. I love one of the matriarchs. And you're from Menifee. Great to have you with us today. Come close. Again, I promise I won't bite.
And anyone also from the students of the Hebrew class or the members of the congregation, would like to come on up right now?
And we are looking at today's portion by Vayakhel, which last week was
Ki
Tisa. So every week on Shabbat we read a portion of the Torah, and we read we are in the book of Exodus, which in Hebrew is the book of
Shemot.
Oh, and our Chazan Mordechai, one of our elders, he just brought out what the Torah portion teaches all of Israel to bring, whether rich or poor, to bring a half shekel. So we have a modern half shekel. We'll treat this as show and tell time. So here's a present day Israeli half shekel. In those days it would have looked differently, but that's the modern version. It's literally a half a shekel, which, what's the rate right now for the shekel to the dollar?
3.4.
Okay, so this is 1.78. I mean, it's a dollar and
about 15 cents, maybe.
Oh, wait a minute. Oh, it's the other way around. I'm calculating. I'm being like the money changers. I'm calculating the wrong way. No. But this is a great illustration. I'll pass it around just to make sure it comes back. And that's what the congregation was asked to bring in this portion, Vayakhel. Now, Vayakhel actually comes from the root kahal we learned in our Hebrew class this morning, and we encourage all of you to come at 9:30 and enjoy a good Hebrew class. We found out that it means to gather together or to assemble as one. And so we refer to a congregation as kehilah, or in the construct form kehilat, as in our Messianic congregation, our sister congregation, kehilat Ariel in San Diego, Rabbi Barney Kasdan. And also we have the other word for a congregation, edah, or edat. Like Adat HaMashiach. Adat HaMashiach come from aid, from the word witness. So a cloud of witnesses, or a congregation of witnesses, you could say, is one way to refer to a congregation, but to assemble together as one is the other way. And we're going to find that in the Torah portion today. So our Chazan is going to take us there. Find the portion. He's going to chant it, which means to canter it, or with his cantillation and traditional melody. Oh, we're using what? Ayad, which is the Hebrew word for hand, but it's also used for a pointer, because you can see the little hand on there. So why do we use that hand and not this hand?
The oil in our hand can actually destroy the parchment.
So out of respect to God and the scroll, the Torah he gave us, so it doesn't get further damage, we use this pointer to point to the portion. So you'll find the portion for us today.
Yes.
And he has to look at each significant break, since there's no chapter or verse in here that's marked. And there's two types of breaks, the petucha, which is the one that opens all the way to the end of the column, which we could call the corridor. And then there's also the stuma, and you point to a stuma or stumot there, the mouth-like opening that only opens up within the portion or the paragraph. And so when we look for the break, we look for the next set of words, reading from right to left, and if it's the portion we're looking for, then acha, we have found it. So we are in the book of Exodus chapter 35, and we are in verse number 1 today. And it goes all the way to 38:20. So that's the chapters that it covers. So this teaches you to study to show yourself approved unto God, right?
Yes.
A workman that needs not to be ashamed.
Vayekel Moshe et kol adat b'nei Yisrael vayomer alehem eile hadevorim asher tziva Adonai la'asot otam sheishe yamim te'aseh melacha u'bayom hashvi'i yehiyeh lachem kodesh Shabbat Shabbaton l'Adonai kol ha'osei bo melacha yumat lo tevaru eish bechol moshvoteichem beyom ha'Shabbat.
Nice. So that's the first three verses there.
Yes.
1 through 3. And I already heard the two words for congregation. We heard the root for the verb that the noun congregation is based upon, kehilah or kehilat for congregation of. And we also heard adat, right?
Yes, we did.
So we heard adat b'nei Israel, the other word for a congregation or an assembly of people in the portion. So why don't you give us some highlights there?
In short, this is now the time when we're looking also at the Sabbath. Moses assembling all the witnesses, if you will. If you think about it, there were witnesses on as far as Sinai was concerned when God had revealed himself there on the mountain. So that's why they are called Edat, the witnesses.
So it's normally translated, though, assembly or a congregation, but the root of it is witness. So that's what a congregation is. We're witnessing the good works or the mighty works of God.
Yes.
Whether at Sinai, through the Sea of Reeds, through the wilderness, through the Promised Land, the giants in the land, no matter what, even the finished work of our Messiah, we are here witnessing. We are his witnesses, right?
Yes.
Isaiah 43:10.
So we are. So we have the witnesses going on, and let me see. And he's saying, as far as like these are the words that are to speak the commandments of the Lord, and you are to do them. Now, and then all of a sudden, we're to do them. Stop. Why? Because we've got 6 days. You shall do your works, do all of them, do all your tasks, and on the seventh day, that shall be a holy day unto the Lord, the Shabbat.
Did you say a seventh day?
The seventh day.
Just wanted to make sure.
Yes. The seventh day.
So uvayom HaShabbat is, and in the day of the seventh day, and it has its own special name. So it's Shabbat what?
Shabbaton.
A Sabbath of Sabbaths, or a Sabbath of complete rest. That is taken into Greek from Shabbaton to Sabbaton, and it's translated Sabbath every time in the Gospels. And in the book of Hebrews, that there's still a rest for the people of God, it should be there's still a Sabbath for the people of God. Why did they choose that one time to not translate it Sabbath? Because it's an implication of, well, we don't need the Sabbath anymore. Because now that Yeshua is already resurrected, he's done away with the law. No, never think that I came to destroy. Yes, to nullify it, to loosen its significance. But I came to fulfill, which would mean to fulfill or give a fuller meaning of. So Yeshua can't destroy the very thing that reveals his fullness.
Amen. Yes.
Okay. So, anything else you see there? That you're not to make fire, right?
It's not in the places they dwell. You're not supposed to make a fire. And also, anyone doing any work on the Shabbat is in this case
they could have incurred the death penalty,
yes.
Which was not offered very often. But in certain cases, it was a deterrent to make sure Israel realized the death penalty is a picture of what happens when you work 7 days a week. Literally, you work yourself to
death.
So sometimes it meant they were excluded from the congregation, cut off. It could also be cut off by the Sanhedrin, that means death. But literally, you're cutting yourself off from life, aren't you?
Yeah.
When you don't rest out of a 7 day week, you're working every day, you're killing yourself.
Even in the book of Numbers, when the man was caught in the book of Numbers, when the man was found to be picking up sticks, and this is right before the issuing of the commandment of Tzitzit, what happened, sadly, they had to execute.
Well, and we would say it's not just an arbitrary thing. It was something specific that he did to defy God in front of all the congregation that I will not do what God says. And anytime someone defied God in that blatant way, mm-hmm. they were judged by him. And so either from heaven or through man on earth, God would use judges to judge right and
yes.
wrong. And if he didn't do that in that way, there would not be the deterrent for other generations to say, we never want to end up like that guy. You know, and it's not so much that God doesn't want you to bend over and pick something up. It's the fact that he refused to stop doing, he took the day that was supposed to be for God and used it for himself. And we're supposed to give this day to God so he can give us back a refreshing of ourselves.
Amen. Yes.
And I don't think we should focus so much on the death, but the life he wants to give us through the Sabbath rest. Amen. All right, so
Amen.
Blessings of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob on all of you today. Thank you for coming up and doing the Torah scroll today, and may you continue to learn from the Hebraic understanding. And we're going to have our five readers read from the Torah. There'll be a prophet reading and also a Brit Hadashah, or New Covenant reading.
A reading from the book of Exodus, chapter 35, verses 1 through 3. Then Moshe assembled all the congregation of Bnei Israel and said to them, "These are the words which Adonai has commanded you to do. Work is to be done for 6 days, but the seventh day is a holy day for you, a Shabbat of complete rest to Adonai. Whoever does any work then will die. Do not kindle a fire in any of your dwellings on Yom Shabbat.
Continuing in Exodus 35, 4 through 9, Moses also said to all the congregation of Bnei Yisrael, this is the word which Adonai commanded, saying, take from among you an offering for Adonai. Whoever has a willing heart, let him bring Adonai's offering, gold, silver, and bronze, blue, purple, and scarlet cloth, fine linen, and goat hair, ram skins dyed red, seal skins and acacia wood, oil for the light, spices for the anointing oil, and for the sweet incense, onyx stones and setting stones for the ephod and for the breastplate.
Continuing in Exodus 36, 1 through 3, Zophar the Ayel and Ohalid are to work along with every wise-hearted man in whom Adonai has placed insight and understanding to know how to perform all the labor for the service of the sanctuary, according to everything Adonai has commanded. Then Moshe called Bazael and Ohalid and the wise-hearted men in whose minds Adonai had set wisdom, along with everyone whose heart stirred up to come to do the work. They received from Moshe the entire offering that Bnei Yisrael had brought for the work of the service of the sanctuary to build it. They brought free will offerings to him morning and after morning.
Continuing in Exodus 37, 1 through 5, Bezalel also made the ark from acacia wood, 2.5 cubits long, 1.5 cubits wide, and 1.5 cubits high. He overlaid it with pure gold inside and out, and made a crown of gold for it all around. He cast 4 golden rings for it in the 4 feet, 2 rings on the one side and 2 on the other. He also made poles of acacia wood and overlaid them with gold. Then he put the poles into the rings on the sides of the ark to carry the ark.
Verse 18, chapter 38. The curtain for the gate of the courtyard was the work of a color weaver of blue, purple, scarlet, and finely twisted linen. It was 20 cubits long and 5 cubits high, like the hangings of the courtyard. Their 4 pillars and 4 bases were bronze. Their hooks, along with the overlaying of their capitals and their bands, were silver. All the pegs of the tabernacle and the courtyard all around were bronze. And this is the word of the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. You know, everything that it took to build the congregation had to be done with a willing heart, and it had to be done with a stirred spirit within them. Their heart had to be stirred. They had to be made willing in their hearts. And I think today we still need that stirring. We need to stir up the gift that is within us that we can contribute to the congregation. We should not forsake the assembling of ourselves together, as Hebrews 10 tells us, but we should stir each other up to do acts of ahava, acts of love, and mitzvot, acts of good deeds, and fulfilling his Torah. And I think if we were to come back to loving God with all our heart, soul, and strength, and loving our neighbor as ourselves, that wouldn't stop on Shabbat. That's even more fulfilled on Shabbat.
Yes.
Because that's a day that we experience that corporate gathering together, for, at least for our congregation, so that we can build each other up. We can encourage each other. And I think this week what stood out for me is that Joshua wouldn't have been the leader he turned out to be if Moses wasn't commanded by God to encourage him and strengthen him. So I have made a commitment to encourage and strengthen my leaders. And I also want to raise up new next generation leaders here. So really, really soon, we're going to have some afternoon yeshiva classes again.
Yeah.
And I'm going to take you through Messianic Discipleship 101. And you guys are going to learn what it means to be a follower of Yeshua from the Gospels and from the writings that the apostles gave us and have left us, that really reinforced Torah, reinforced the fulfillment of the prophets, and reinforced what the royal writings were really trying to tell us, that we're to be one. And we're to welcome people from our community to come in and learn together. Yeshua said, learn of me. My yoke is easy, my burden is light. We should never make it so hard for a Gentile to come in and learn the ways of the Torah. We should make it easy, not like the Pharisees that put extra burdens on them. We should make it light. We should be aware of leaven, allowing our pride and our arrogance to puff us up to think, well, I know more Torah than you. I know more Hebrew than you. I'm more blessed than you. I have a bigger position than you. Guess what? To be a minister means to be a servant. So if anything, you guys are up here to me, and I'm down here serving you. So it's not about position or title. It's about function. Let's start fulfilling our function as a believer today. And let's not only believe in our God, but believe in his leaders and believe in one another. Amen. Let's believe for our best. Let's believe to strive for greater. 2016 is not a year of being mediocre. It is a year of going above and beyond the call of duty. We need all hands on deck. Amen. We need everybody giving their half shekel. We need everybody saying, hey, I want to learn how to make challah bread. I want to provide. Guess what? Panera might not always be around, but you are. Guess what? Shabbat's always going to be here, even into eternity. We're going to have that Shabbat rest in a greater fulfillment. But until that time, let us come together and assemble as one. Let us encourage each other to do good works. Let us fulfill the words of the writer of Hebrew, where he says, do not forsake the assembling of yourselves together. Amen. It's one of my verses today, and I really believe that God wants us to encourage each other and strengthen each other. Hazak, hazak, b'ni hazak. I know we're not done with Shemot yet. Oh, actually, we are.
Actually, next week we are.
Next week. We have what normally this yes, week's man. Portion and next week's would be read together. But in the leap year, we actually have them read separately. So we have one more reading of the book of Shemot, and then we're on to the book of Leviticus.
Yes,
the book that all children in Israel learn first because of their great little brains that can remember all those details. I hope that we break down Leviticus in ways that make it simple as a child to understand.
Amen.
But as wise as a sage to grab a hold of and say, this is deep stuff. This is deep calling to deep today. Amen?
Amen.
So let's say the, it's the first book taught to children. I promise you, their little brains can soak it all in. Then they go back and start with Genesis. Because all those wonderful details that you and I say, I got to read the book of Leviticus. It's so tiring and tedious. Yeah, it is, but you got to study. Study, 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 right? And so let's say the closing blessing for the Torah today.
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher natalanu Torah emet, mechaye olam ata betocheinu, Baruch atah Adonai, notein haTorah. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who gave us the Torah of truth and life everlasting, planted in our midst. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah. Amen.
I'm so excited.
Yes.
No, I'm telling you, I'm so excited. We're going to be doing something. Our elders are going to be talking about how we can trim down our service a little bit so that when we come back, we're not exhausted and tired. We can get a nice lunch in. But we can come back and do yeshiva together in the afternoons. Because I don't want anyone to say, oh, I've been here all morning. And, you know, but I really believe, I'm sorry to interrupt this before we do the hakba, but I'm really excited. As you lift that up, guess what? God's going to lift our hands. He's going to lift us up. He's going to encourage us because this is our year of learning. Amen?
Amen.
Ooh, I love it. Now for the hakba, which reveals three panels of reading today to the congregation. We point to it as edah, as a witness. The congregation of witnesses, and we declare this is the word of the Lord.
B'zot ha-Torah asher sam Moshe lifnei b'nei Yisrael al Yadonai v'ayin Moshe. And this is the Torah that Moses placed for the children of Israel at the command of the Lord by the hand of Moses. Amen.
Beautiful. And now the belt of truth to go around the waist of the Torah, just as we should wear the belt of truth around our waist. And the breastplate that goes around it. Next week, one of our devotional words is breastplate. We should have a breastplate of righteousness over our hearts. Amen.
Amen.
Today, we redress the Torah just like a bride adorned for her husband. Today, Messiah has become the fulfillment of the Father's covenant to Israel and to all those that will call upon the name of the Lord, Jew and Gentile alike. Today, we are one redeemed people. We are his remnant. We are looking for the coming of Messiah. May we always have a pointer, like the Torah, to point towards Messiah. Amen.
Amen.
Let's declare that the Torah is the tree of life as Yeshua fulfills it and becomes our life, our eternal life, who died on a tree to give us that life. And let's place it back into the Torah with the words of Proverbs, Etz Hayim, the tree of life.
Et ha'imhi l'machazikim ba betoncheha me'ushar derachheha darchei noam mechad tivotecha shalom Hashivenu Adonai Elecha benashuva Chadesh, Chadesh Yameinu Chadesh Yameinu Kekedem.
It is a tree of life for those who take hold of it, and those who support it are praiseworthy. Its ways are ways of pleasantness, and all its paths are peace. Bring us back, O Lord, to you, and we shall come. Renew our days as of old. Amen. This time we will have the Haftra, which is the prophet reading. And this week's reading lines up perfectly with the portion of Vayakhel. Let's say the blessing together.
Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher Bachar Binim Tovim Veratzah Redimehem Hanemarim Be'emet Baruch Ata Adonai Habocher Batorah LeMoshe Abdo LeYisrael Amo LeBnei HaEmet BaTzedek Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has chosen the prophets and was pleased with their words that were uttered with truth. Blessed are you, O Lord, who chooses the Torah, Moses his servant, Israel his nation, and the prophets of truth and righteousness. Amen.
Today we have Vayakhel, which lines up with 1 Kings 7:26 in the Ashkenazi, in the Sephardic and Hasidic tradition, and then the Ashkenazi is 1 Kings 7:40-50. I'm going to read just a little bit of starting in verse 13, just to give the Sephardic tradition a little emphasis. It says in chapter 1 Kings 7:13 in the Arskel Chumash version, it says, King Solomon sent and bought Hiram of Tyre from Tyre. He was the son of a widow from the tribe of Naphtali, and his father, a resident of Tyre, and was a coppersmith. He was filled with wisdom, which is what the Torah says those that built the tabernacle was filled with. He was filled with wisdom, insight, knowledge to perform all the work of copper, so that he came to King Solomon and performed all of this work. I'm going to go over to, in the same chapter, verse 40. Hiram made the lavers and the shovels and the blood basins, and Hiram finished doing all the work that he did for King Solomon for the house of Adonai. The two columns and the two globes of the capitals that were atop the columns, and the two netted ornaments to cover the two globes of the capitals that were atop the columns, and the 400 pomegranates for the two netted ornamentations, two rows of pomegranates for each netted ornamentation to cover the two globes of the capitals that are on the upper surface of the columns, and the 10 pedestals and the 10 lavers upon the pedestals, and the one sea, or a molten sea, and the 12 oxen under the sea, referring to the labor, and the pots and the shovels and the blood basins, all the vessels that Hiram made for King Solomon for the house of Adonai were of burnished copper. I'm going to jump down to verse 48. Solomon made all the vessels that were in the house of Adonai, the golden altar, the table, referring to the table of showbread, upon which the bread was placed, was gold, and the candelabra, or the menorah, five to the right and five to the left, five menorahs on one side, five on the other, before the Holy of Holies, where were of refined gold, and the blossom, the lamps, and the tongs were of gold, and all the bowls, and the musical instruments, and the blood basins, and the spoons, the fire pans, were all of refined gold. And the hinges for the innermost chamber of the house, the Holy of Holies, for the doors of the hall of the house were of gold. It's interesting that the vessels that were for judgment were bronze, or this burnished copper. and the ones for God's glory were gold. So every element is unique for the building of not only the tabernacle and the temple. In fact, the sockets, many of them were made with they were made with silver, like the silver shekel, and that is a picture of redemption. And when you think about the different metals, and you think about the three rooms of the tabernacle and how it was the same three rooms of the temple, even though they were more menorahs, because the temple was bigger in the holy place, and there were the oxen to hold up, the bronze or copper oxen to hold up the laver, which was bigger than the one for the in the tabernacle. Everything was still of the same design. You know what that shows you and I? When we get our new bodies, we're still going to be us, but we're going to look better. Yeah. We're going to be more powerful. We're going to be glorified. Because Rav Shaul, the Apostle Paul, said, see this old tent I've got now? To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. I'm clothed with this tabernacle now, but I can't wait for the new tabernacle I'll have in heaven. Right now we're temples of the Holy Spirit, but can you imagine what it's like to have the Holy Spirit not just in us, but upon us and working through us, that for 1,000 years we'll be teaching Torah with full revelation and anointing of how every jot and tittle, every detail of the Torah has a significance in Yeshua the Messiah, and it shows why he had to die and raise from the dead, and all the questions we have between the older and the newer covenants, all those answers will be in our own hearts and minds, because he's inscribed the Torah in our heart now. But then it'll be on our lips, and we'll be speaking it with full revelation. Are you looking forward for that day? You'll all know perfect Hebrew. You won't have to join a bar or bat mitzvah class. You will know Hebrew perfectly, because that will be the holy tongue that God says, I will restore a holy tongue to my people, in Zephaniah 3:9. Right now, we're just in practice mode. All hands on deck. We're getting ready for the big day when Messiah comes out of the clouds of glory and touches down on the Mount of Olives, according to Zechariah 14. Guess what? We will all be in the land of Israel. We will all be in that holy land, and all nations will come unless they don't want any rain on their crops. And you know what? Sukkot is not the same without the rain, because we have to celebrate the final harvest. What I'm looking for is the final harvest of souls coming in. Our sons and our daughters, our aunts, our uncles, our mothers, our fathers, our cousins, our nephews, everyone that we come in contact with, the neighbor, the grocery store clerk, the manager at that store, the boss that you have over your life that doesn't always treat you so nice. Come on. All the people in your life that you're trying to share the light of Yeshua to and share the love of Yeshua with. But one day, the Bible says, they will all know me. Because every knee will bow. And every tongue will confess that Yeshua, the Messiah, is Lord. Amen. And my sermon's done. Let's do the benediction. No, can we say the blessing together for the haftarah? Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu, melech haolam, sur kol haolamim, tzadik b'chol ha'arot, ha'el ha'neiman, ha'omer ve'oseh, ha'mdaber u'mkayem, shechol devarav, emet v'atzedek. Ne'aman atah hu Adonai Eloheinu, v'nemerim devarecha, Vidivar echad midvarecha, achur lo yeshurekam, ki el melech neiman barakamalata, barukata Adonai, ha'em neiman b'chod erav. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, Rock of all eternities, righteous in all generations, the trustworthy God who says and does, who speaks and fulfills, all of whose words are true and righteous. Trustworthy are you, O Lord our God, and trustworthy are your words. Not one of your words is turned back to its origin unfulfilled. For you are God, trustworthy and compassionate King. Blessed are you, O Lord, the God who is trustworthy in all his words. Amen. Have mercy on Zion, for it's the source of our life. And to the one who is deeply humbled, bring salvation speedily in our days. Blessed are you, O Lord, who gladdened Zion through her children. Amen. Gladden us, O Lord our God, with Elijah, the prophet, your servant, and with the kingdom of the house of David, your anointed Messiah. May he come speedily and cause our heart to exalt. And on his throne let no stranger sit, nor let others continue to inherit his honor. For by your holy name you swore to him that his lamp would not be extinguished forever and ever. Blessed are you, O Lord, shield of David, Magen David. Amen. Al ha-Torah, al ha-Godah, Av ha-Nevi'im, al yom ha-Shabbat ha-Zeh, Shenatata lanu Adonai Eloheinu, Likdusha v'limnucha, Lechavod u'letifaret.
Al hakol Adonai Eloheinu, anachnu modim lach, lurachim otach, yibarach shumcha b'fiko hai, temin leolam ba'ed, baruch ata Adonai, b'kadesh ha-shabbat. Amen.
For the Torah reading, for the prayer service, for the reading from the prophets, and for this Sabbath day that you, O Lord our God, have given us, for holiness and contentment, for glory and splendor. For all this, O Lord our God, we gratefully thank you and bless you. May your name be blessed by the mouth of all the living always, for all eternity. Blessed are you, O Lord, who sanctifies the Sabbath. Amen. For those who wonder why we bow our knee as the Brit HaShavah reader comes at this time, the word for knee is berech, from the same root, baruch, which means to bend the knee to God. One knee, one day, every knee will bow, and every tongue will confess. So this is like our practice time, right? We bow before him to say he's blessed. When we bow before him, he gives us his blessing. And so that anointing comes when we bow ourselves like the king that knights a new knight, and we are like priests anointed with fresh oil on our heads every time we bow before him. So at this time, we will say the blessing for the Brit HaShavah. And it's good to have Pressy back. I heard you were a little under the weather. But now you're out of the weather, and
yes,
you're in the congregation now and ready to read. Amen.
Yes. Amen. Thank you.
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher natan lanu Mashiach Yeshua, v'hadarim shel ha'brit ha'chadasha. Baruch atah Adonai, noteinu ha'brit ha'chadasha. Amen.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us Messiah Yeshua and the words of the new covenant. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the new covenant. Amen.
Today's reading is from, we have two readings.
Yeah, we have two, but we're just going to read the first one, 1 Corinthians 3, 11
to 18.
1
Corinthians chapter 3, verses 11 to 18. For no one can lay any other foundation than what is already laid, which is Yeshua the Messiah. Now, if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become clear, for the day will show it, because it is to be revealed by fire, and the fire itself will test each one's work, what sort it is. If anyone's work built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss. He himself will be saved, but as through fire. Don't you know that you are God's temple, and that the Ruach Elohim dwells among you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is holy, and you are that temple. Let no one deceive himself. If anyone thinks he is wise in his age, let him become a fool, so he may become wise.
Amen.
Amen. Now, this is the word of the Lord.
This is the word of the Lord. Now, I want you to think how beautifully this goes along with our portion. We read about the building of the tabernacle and the precious gold and silver and things that were to be used for it. We also read about Solomon's temple that was built with the same precious gold and silver as a foundation to build the house of God. I said earlier that we are the tabernacle. We have a body as a tabernacle. His glory is his spirit within us. And then we're also called the temple. So whether it's Moses' tabernacle with three rooms, Solomon's temple with three rooms, we also have three rooms, spirit, soul, and body. The Holy of Holies, where God's glory dwelt, is like our spirit. The holy place is our soul. Three pieces of furniture in there, the table of showbread, the menorah, the altar of incense. We have three areas of the soul, the mind, the emotions, and the will. And then you have the outer court, which is like the outer man, or our body. And we have a sacrifice of praise. When we praise our God in the physical court, we also have to have our bodies washed with pure water. Where did that happen? In the outer court. So three rooms for God to dwell in. Now, this is the beautiful thing. It says, you're either going to lay a foundation with gold or silver or precious stones, like the tabernacle and temple, or you're going to lay a foundation that's not very stable, wood, hay, and stubble. or straw, guess what happens in the Day of Judgment? It all burns up. Imagine if Moses built it out of hay, wood, and straw without overlaying it with the gold, having the silver, and the precious stones. It would all burn up. When the presence of God was there, it couldn't take the presence.
Amen.
Fire by night, cloud by day. The altar that burned with fire, the altar of incense that burned with fire, the menorah, couldn't handle it if it was wood. But because it was overlaid with gold, it could handle the fire. And our lives are like precious gold in the fire, tried seven times. Amen. And we are like that precious tabernacle or temple that God wants to dwell in. He says, we can't build our lives on hay, wood, or stubble. We got to build our lives on the precious gold, silver, and the precious stones. And I think about all the tribes of Israel with the precious stones that were laid in the breastplate. And I think about the gold that represents His glory and the silver that represents redemption. When we do it for God's glory and we allow Messiah to redeem us, like He did the 12 tribes, the precious stones, we become the precious stones. You know the 12 tribes of Israel? There were set the 12 foundations in the New Jerusalem described in the book of Revelation. Guess whose names are inscribed on those 12 foundations? The 12 apostles of the Lamb, not the tribes, because now the last should be first, the first should be last. Who are the disciples picked based upon? The 12 tribes. 12 disciples for the 12 tribes. Where, who will they rule over? The 12 tribes of Israel. So who laid the foundation for Messiah? It's actually the apostles that did. But who is able to have access to those pearly gates? The 12 tribes, because their names are written on the 12 pearly gates. And so you see that what God did was when Israel couldn't see Him as the Messiah, He used 12 to bring them back to Him so they could have access into the kingdom or New Jerusalem, to their own city. Because if unfaithful branches are taken off, I'll engraft them back in, He says, if they'll become faithful. Isn't that beautiful today? That we can build our lives as a temple for God's Spirit to dwell in? That's what it says at the end. So it says, look at your lives. Examine it. Make sure you're that vessel. Make sure you're that temple. Make sure you're that tabernacle where His glory abides. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's say the closing blessing. Man, I feel like I don't even need a sermon today. Closing blessing for the Brit Hadashah. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam Asher natan lanu divrei emet V'chayim olam natan betochenu Baruch atah Adonai Noten ha-Brit Hadashah Amen. Blessed are You, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who gave us the words of truth and life everlasting, planted in our midst. Blessed are You, O Lord, giver of the new covenant. Amen. Praise the Lord. Somebody give God a praise today. Amen. Amen. Shabbat shalom, everyone. Boker tov. Going to be in the house of the Lord today. Do you tell your neighbor boker tov? Shabbat shalom. We're going to get into a message today called Stir Me Up. Can you say that? Stir me up, Lord. Stir me up, Lord. And today it comes from Parashat Vayakhel, which is almost the last portion of the book of Shemot or Exodus. And we like to say a hearty Baruchim Haba'im to all of our first-time guests here today. And Shabbat Shalom to all of you. And we are taking this message today from the book of Shemot, Exodus 35:1 through 38:20. Melachim Aleph would be 1 Kings 7:40 through 50 was the major part of the read from the Ashkenazi community. And also 1 Corinthians 3:11 through 18. We read today, you can also read 2 Corinthians 9:6 through 11 to relate to the Torah portion. How many are ready for 10 minutes of Torah today? Woo! Oh, are you ready today?
Yes.
All right. We're going to start with the TLV version of Exodus 35:1, and the first verse here has the meaning of the portion, which is to assemble together, and Vayakhel would be the Hebrew words for assembled. So let's read this version, Exodus 35:1. It says, "Then Moses assembled all the congregation of Israel, or B'nai Israel, and said to them, these are the words which Adonai has commanded you to do. Work is to be done how many days?
6 days.
6 days. And on the seventh day is a holy day for you, a Shabbat of complete rest, Shabbat Shabbaton in Hebrew, to Adonai. Whoever does any work then will die. Do not kindle a fire in any of your dwellings on Yom Shabbat, which is a specific day of the week, the seventh day. Moses also said to all the congregation of Bnei Israel, the sons of Israel, this is the word which Adonai commanded, saying. So here you have the concept of assembling together, especially for Shabbat. And Shabbat is made for the rest, not just the rest of Israel, but for the rest of our lives, right? Mm-hmm. To be a rest to our life. And Yeshua taught us that man was not made for the Sabbath, but Sabbath, referring to the seventh day, the Sabbath was made for man. Now, who was the first man God created?
Adam.
So in 6 days he created the world. And the Bible says that on that sixth day he created man, Adam, from the ground. And that man would work 6 days as God created 6 days. And man would then take that seventh day as a day of rest. And God refreshed himself the way he wants to refresh us. That means he rested, which means he sat down on the throne of his glory as creator over his creation. So that's why we refrain from creative work as much as possible, so that we can have recreation. We can have that recreating of refreshing, renewing, rejuvenating our lives. If you work, work, work all day long, you will not have rest. You need to have that conclusion to your work week and say, you know, if I can't get it done in 6 days, one more day is not going to get it done. Just own it. There's not 25 hours in a day. One more hour is not going to get anything more done. In fact, the more time you have, the more time you waste.
Yes.
I'll tell you the biggest way we wasted today. Scrolling through Facebook instead of having our face in the book, right? Oh, I gotta take this picture. Then I gotta, you know, I gotta do a selfie. Then I gotta Instagram it. Then I gotta send it to Twitter. Then I gotta, you know what? Sometimes we focus too much on externals.
Yep.
And not about the internal reason why God gave us Shabbat, and that's for rest. Let's continue on. In verse 5, there's a component about this rest. It takes everybody to be willing to work together as one family, as one house, as one team. Look at verse 5. Take among from among you an offering for Adonai. Whoever has a what?
Willing
heart, let him bring Adonai's offering of what? Gold, silver, bronze, blue, purple, scarlet cloth, fine linen, goat hair, ram skin, dyed red, seal's skin, of acacia wood. This is the wood called shittim. It's the same wood to make the Ark of the Covenant. It's the same wood that had thorns on its branches that were like nails that were used, it's believed, that were used to make the crown of thorns for Yeshua's head. These nails, or these thorns, look like nails this big. So they're not the little rose bush stuff that we think of. They were huge. Just Google it, you'll find out. It says, it goes on to say, they're going to bring the acacia wood, which is shittim, oil for lights, spices for anointing oil, for the sweet incense, onyx stones, setting stones for the ephod, which we sometimes call the ephod, and for the breastplate. Look at verse 10. Let every wise-hearted man among you come and make everything that Adonai has commanded. So if you're going to bring what Adonai has commanded, you have to be what?
Wise-hearted.
So not only do you have to have a willing heart, you have to have a wise heart. Okay? Now, let's take a look at verse 21 in the passage and see what else we need. It says in verse 21, everyone whose heart stirred him, and everyone whose spirit was what?
Willing.
So we had a willing heart, a wise heart. Now we have to be stirred in our heart through a willing spirit. And he says, they came and brought Adonai's offering for the work of the tent of meeting and for all of its services, as well as for the holy garments. For what? The holy garments. Now, let's go to chapter. It's okay. Let's go to the. I'll take a look at the Hebrew words here in the text, because we actually looked at a couple of different references. We looked at the willing heart, a wise heart. We looked at a heart that's stirred, and a willing spirit. Okay? So let's take a look at willing heart. In Hebrew, the word is nadiv libo. Can you say that? Nadiv libo. Libo means his heart, from the word lev. You know the letter bet, without the little dot or dagesh in the center of the letter. It's like the picture of a little house in pictographic Hebrew or Paleo Hebrew. And it can be a V sound or it can be a B. So in this case, without the suffix that you see at the end O, or the vav here, it would be a B sound with the vav. It would be a V sound without it. Lev becomes libo, okay? So nadiv libo. And this translates in, especially modern Hebrew, is to have a generous heart. I just found that very interesting. To have a willing heart means to have a generous heart. I actually looked up the word in my Hebrew app, and I typed in nadiv. And nadiv, or in this case, in construct state, nediv, it translates to generous. How many of the Lord wants us to be generous? So generous people are willing people.
Amen.
People that are willing to give because it's the right thing to do. That's why we call giving tzedakah. Tzedakah means righteousness. Our tzedakah boxes are placed in the entrance for you to bring your own offering because you're generous. No one has to beg you. We don't pass a plate and force you. Now in the beginning of a new moon or new month, we do bring the tzedakah boxes up front and blow the shofars over them as a monthly blessing for the Rosh Chodesh blessing. And we're actually going to start having more of a Rosh Chodesh celebration. That's one of the things I want to bring back this year, is really celebrate a little bit more the Rosh Chodesh celebration. Maybe do a few of the blessings and bring something fresh and new to you every month. But the beauty of it is that there has to be a willing heart. Now, the second thing we see is the word willing spirit in Hebrew, and it's nadiva. Nadiva, nadiva. Now, Patricia's Hebrew name is what?
Nadiva.
Nadiva. So this is the word. Now, you remember the son that died, the son of Aaron? They brought unauthorized, strange fire. He died with his brother Avihu, and his name is Nadav. Your Bible might say Nadav with a B at the end. Remember the B and the V are interchangeable. So Nadav means free will. It can be translated generous, but it means free will. So with this free will, he chose to bring something unauthorized.
Right.
And sometimes we use our free will for the wrong things, right?
Yes.
We can use free will to be generous, or we could be rebellious. And we have to check ourselves. Do we have a willing spirit? Is our will lined up with his will?
Right.
If that's the case, we'll be generous as God is generous. God is a giving God, isn't he? For God so loved, he gave.
Right.
He gave us his son. Now, this term is coupled with the word ruach, but in this case it's spelled rucho, his spirit. So it means to have a generous spirit. So you not only have to have a generous heart, but your spirit, man, your spiritual nature needs to be one of generosity. So a generous heart and a generous spirit, they're kind of synonymous terms, but they all relate to areas of our makeup, spirit, soul, and body. But then you break down the spirit, you also have your heart and your conscience. This is part of your spiritual man. So the spiritual man is comprised of spirit, heart, and conscience. So we have to have a willing heart and a willing spirit. Next phrase is chacham lev, which means to be skilled with wisdom. It means to have a wise heart. Wise-hearted is chacham lev, the heart of a sage, the heart of a wise scholar, the heart of a studier of God's word, the heart of a researcher. A wise heart is someone who seeks out wisdom. How many want to be wise sages? Not the spice, but wise, as wise sages, a man of wisdom, a scholar, a Torah scholar spiritually, that you're able to give people wisdom because you know the word, you've learned it, and you apply it to your life. And the final one is stirred heart, nisa'o libo. And this one's interesting. It's from the root naso. So we learned from ki tisa, to lift up, right? Wasn't that just last week? Ki tisa, to lift up the heads of the children of Israel. Our Bible says a census, take a census. No, we lift up their heads and look at them eye to eye in their face and get to know who they are. Know them by name. And so the concept of lifting up, have you ever been down? Let me see the hands of those. Just this last week you had a depressing news, something happened, and you just got downhearted. You felt down. Just be honest. I'll tell you, I heard some things that just made me a little bit downhearted. A couple things had nothing to do with this congregation, but just in general. And over this last month, there's been some things that have troubled my spirit where I just felt down. So God says, stir your heart up, or let your heart be lifted up or stirred up. So when someone tells you a testimony, it just stirs you up. When someone says to you, you prayed for me last week, and guess what? The healing started to take place the moment you prayed, or that encouraging word you gave me. All of a sudden, I just get stirred up when I hear that something I said to someone or something I did in obedience cause them to be stirred up or be blessed or to be encouraged. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, I'm stirred up. I'm lifted up. So guess what? A great way to be encouraged is to encourage somebody else.
Amen.
Moses was told, encourage and strengthen Joshua. Chazak, chazak. V'nit hazek, we say. Be strong, and you will be strengthened. So these terms are found in the text. I want to go to another reference of being stirred up. In Exodus 36:2, it says, then Moses called Bezalel, Oholiab, and all the wise-hearted men whose minds Adonai had set wisdom, along with everyone whose heart stirred him up to come do the work. I didn't highlight that phrase there, but notice wise-hearted again, and notice wisdom. So a wise sage, wise-hearted, is someone who has wisdom. And it says, along with everyone whose heart stirred him up to come and do the work. So the only way to build a house is for people to be stirred up to build it, to come and contribute, to come and give their time, talent, and treasure. I'll just give you a couple other references. If I go back to Exodus 28:3, it says, so you shall speak to all who are gifted artisans, whom I have filled with the what?
Spirit
of wisdom. Now you're not just seeking wisdom, you're seeking it from the Holy Spirit, who is the Spirit of wisdom. That's one of the titles or attributes of the Holy Spirit, that they may make Aaron's garments. Even down to the garments, you had to have the Holy Spirit's anointing of wisdom to be able to fulfill a very physical task. Isn't that a beautiful thing? That they may minister to me as priests. And then finally, let's look at Exodus 31. It says, verse 3, and I have filled him with the what? Spirit of God. Now it clarifies, the Spirit of God in what? In wisdom, in understanding, in knowledge. Does that sound familiar? The Holy Spirit would be our wisdom, our understanding, our knowledge. It says, in all manner of workmanship, down to the artistic works, the gold, the silver, the bronze, the cutting of the jewels. Remember, no other foundation can you lay but the one that's laid in Messiah. And we should build on with the gold, the silver, and the precious stones we read today in 1 Corinthians. Was that 1 Corinthians 3? 1 Corinthians 3, 11 through 18 we read. And so, for the Brit Hashar reading, notice what it says. This was the foundation. A couple more references, just in chapter 35, to make this point clear. Look what it says in 35:29. The children of Israel brought a free will offering. There is that root again, Nadav. Free will offering to the Lord, all the men and women whose heart were willing to bring material for all kinds of work, which the Lord, by the hand of Moses, had commanded to be done. I'm going to jump on to verse number 31. And he filled him with the what? Spirit of God in what? In all wisdom and understanding and in knowledge. I love this. He filled him with wisdom and understanding and knowledge. Now, how many ready for the Haftarah? So, in the Haftarah or the prophet reading, I want to go to Isaiah 11:2. You probably knew I was going to go here. Isaiah 11:2, it says, the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. Who's the him?
Jesus.
Messiah, right? And now we know the Messiah to be Yeshua, but it's on the Messiah. Any rabbi, Orthodox or Reform, will say, this verse is referring to the Messiah. It's no doubt. In all Jewish writings, this is the Messiah. So it says, the Spirit of the Lord will rest upon him. This is the root of David, right? This is the descendant of Jesse. He says, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel, the spirit of might, the spirit of knowledge, and the fear of the Lord. So if you really break that down, there's seven titles there. The spirit of the Lord, spirit of wisdom, spirit of understanding, spirit of counsel, spirit of might, spirit of knowledge, spirit of the fear of the Lord. If you look at those seven, they're described in the book of Revelation as the seven spirits of God, which are the seven lamps of fire burning for his throne. How many lamps of fire did the menorah have in the holy place of the tabernacle?
Seven.
So the menorah's light represents the illumination of the Holy Spirit in your life. When the priests would minister, they needed the Spirit of the Lord to rest upon them. They needed the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, counsel and might, and knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And this is very powerful because we found out the tabernacle couldn't have been built without it. So you can build a house on sand, or you can build it on a firm foundation. You can build a house on your own might or on the might of the Spirit of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Unless the Lord builds the house, we who labor, labor in what?
Amen.
In vain. Now, look what Haggai says. Haggai, chapter 6, verse 1, Haggai, or the book of Haggai. Then Adonai stirred the spirit of Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, the governor of Judah, and the spirit of Joshua, son of Jehozadak, Kohen Gadol, and the spirit of all the remnant of the people, and they came, all of them, and did the work of the house of Adonai, Sevaoth, their God. Wait a minute. So the same way Moses built the tabernacle with the help of all those that contributed, the same way Solomon built the temple we found in our reading out of 1 Kings with the spirit of wisdom and the laying of the gold and the silver and the precious stones. But now when the temple has been destroyed and rebuilt in the days of Zerubbabel, the same work to rebuild the temple was the same work to build it the first time. The same work to build the temple was the same work to build the tabernacle. Do you know if you and I are a temple or a tabernacle for God to dwell in, it takes the same work to build us? I can't hear an amen.
Amen.
We need this, the Ruach Adonai, the Ruach Chokmah. We need that wisdom. We need understanding, Binah. We need that counsel, that might, that knowledge, and the fear of the Lord. We need the da'at of the Lord, the knowledge of God. We still need the Holy Spirit in our life today. In fact, there's one thing that believers always claim, where the temples the Holy Spirit can dwell in. Don't you know the type of shadow was Moses? And the type of shadow was Solomon. And now the type of shadow is, again, Zerubbabel, seeing the house of God being built in his days with Joshua the high priest. It's amazing. Picture of Yeshua, because you know Joshua and Yeshua are the same name. Right?
Yep.
So, let's look at another passage. 2 Chronicles, in Hebrew would be called Divrei Hayamim Beit, or 2 Chronicles 36:22. Look what it says. Now in the first year of King Cyrus of Persia, fulfilling the word of Adonai by the mouth of Jeremiah, Adonai stirred up the spirit of the king of who? King Cyrus of Persia, so that he sent a proclamation throughout all his kingdom, also put it in writing. And what did he say? He said, thus says King Cyrus of Persia, Adonai, the God of heaven, has given me all the kingdoms of the earth. He has appointed me to what? Build him a house in Jerusalem, which is in Judah. Whoever among you of all his people may go up, whoever among you of all his people may go up, and may Adonai, his God, be with you, be with him. So notice that Moses had to have the Spirit of God. His craftsmen had to have the Spirit of God. The Israelites bringing the shekels had to have the Spirit of God. Those women that were weaving had to have the Spirit of God. Solomon had to have the Spirit of God. And Hiram, who was building for Solomon, had to have the Spirit of God.
Amen.
Zerubbabel had to have the Spirit of God. Joshua had to have the Spirit of God for the second temple to be rebuilt after the Babylonian exile. And here you have King Cyrus of Persia, the king who releases them to go build. He even needs the Spirit of God. I wish we could get all the presidents and kings of this world to have the Spirit of God speak to them about Israel again.
Amen.
I wish that all of the dromedaries and camels of the Queen of Sheba could come back and lay at the feet of Solomon the riches of this world that will become the riches of our God one day, and the kingdoms of this world become the kingdoms of our God and of his Messiah. When we bring the resources of nations, the Bible says, the wealth of the nations are going to come to Israel.
Amen.
It's trickling in now. Nations are pouring in money to Israel. Best way to pour in money to Israel is go.
That's right.
Wouldn't you like to go?
Yeah.
Wouldn't it be great if we could plan a trip to go to Israel? We always say it, but let's do it. Now, it says that we may all go up. Come, let us go up unto the mountain of the Lord and to the house of the God of Jacob. Boom, 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 boom. Come, let us go up unto the mountain of the Lord and to the house of the God of Jacob, into the house of the God of Jacob, into the house of the God of Jacob. Boom, boom. You guys are awesome. Oh, we might add some people to the worship team. All right. How many are ready for the Brit Hadashah as we bring this message to a close? Remember, this is all based on 10, 10, 10. That's what you can do throughout the week. Have that 30 minutes with God. Maybe 10 minutes in the morning, 10 minutes in the afternoon, 10 minutes in the evening. Take that morning manna that's on the back of your outline and just go through each day devotional and have a time with God every day. You know, maybe take the rest of that time and have a half hour prayer. Pray those scriptures. Because, really, Yeshua said, can't you just pray with me 1 hour? What if we started praying the word that we're reading? Pray the word. Pray the principles of the word. Proclaim the promise before the problem even tries to raise its ugly head. And when the problem comes, unexpected, you already have a promise in your heart. No, no, the word of God says. No, enemy, it is written, right? You have to know what's been written. The only way to do that is to get that morning manna. So let's take a look at our Brit Hadashah passage. I love this one, the book of Hebrews, what David Stern calls Messianic Jews. These were Jewish believers that were being convinced that Yeshua couldn't be the Messiah by the Pharisees. So apologetically, the writer of Hebrews, some try to say it's Paul, some Apollos, some Silas, some Barnabas, different beliefs out there. I kind of lean towards Apollos, someone who traveled in the same camp as Paul. But nonetheless, the writer of Hebrews is speaking about tabernacle days, relating it to temple times that he was writing in before the destruction of the temple. Because he talks about the sacrifices as present day active activities of the priests. If you read the book of Hebrews, he's not saying they used to do it. He's saying they're doing it right now. So it had to be before 70 AD because this book is speaking of present day activity in Jerusalem at the temple. So it wasn't destroyed yet, which happened by the Romans in 70 AD, the way Babylon destroyed the former temple in 586 BC. So be encouraged that he's relating tabernacle patterns to temple times and relating it to believers because we are also a tabernacle for God to dwell in. Amen? Amen?
Amen.
So look what Hebrews 10 says. Hebrews 10, 19 says, therefore, brothers and sisters, we have boldness to enter into the holies. The holies are the holiest by the blood of Yeshua. Now, sometimes believers get this confused. And they say, well, see, that's why the veil of the temple was rent so we could go into the Holy of Holies. Well, first of all, Yeshua was not trying to go into the earthly tabernacle or the earthly temple during the time of the Romans. He was not trying to go into that one. He's not a Levite. He wouldn't even try to go into that earthly one, which that's a pattern for the original heavenly reality. Yeshua didn't go into the Holy of Holies on earth, but he went to the original Holy of Holies. Where? In heaven. He's talking about when he ascended to the Father and came before him and testified through his blood that their sins have been forgiven. Like on the Day of Atonement, when the priest would go in to the Holy of Holies before the presence of God on earth and sprinkle the blood 7 times. How many times?
Seven times.
So let's keep reading. He says, therefore, brothers and sisters, we have boldness to enter the holies by the blood of Yeshua. Now you have to know, he's referring to the Day of Atonement. Because the priest never goes into the Holy of Holies except once a year. And what day is that on? Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. Any other day, they go into the holy place before the veil, but never beyond the veil. They are in the outer court offering sacrifices, but one day a year, can they go into the Holy of Holies? When Yeshua went into heaven, he was fulfilling the spiritual reality of entering into the Holy of Holies, the original one in heaven. So look what it says. He inaugurated a new and living way for us through the curtain or through the veil. But how did he do that? That is his flesh. So he's telling you that the veil is a picture of his flesh. I want you to think about this. Until he committed his spirit in the hands of the Father, he was still in the tabernacle or behind the veil. His glory was hidden to humanity. Nobody knew that Yeshua was the Son of God until he did miracles. And they saw his glory, like when it says he turned water to wine, or H2O to Merlot. That just means that he did something miraculous and they saw his glory. When he raised the dead, they saw his glory. When he was transfigured, they saw his glory. When they saw him ascend, they saw his glory. But when he comes back, we've not seen that glory yet. He's coming with the full Shekinah glory of the Father. The Shekinah, the presence of God, is going to come in full manifestations. And he's going to come down and touch down on the Mount of Olives. Are you looking for that day?
Yes.
So in the meantime, the flesh of Yeshua was a veil that shielded us from his true glory. And when he died, his spirit left his body So the glory was no longer behind the veil. That's what the reference is. He's talking about the death of Yeshua here. Because think about it, Yeshua's not just the high priest, he's also what? The sacrificial lamb. So no one took his life, he laid it down. Because who lays the animal on the altar? The high priest. Well, how could Yeshua be the high priest and the lamb? Because he laid his own life down.
Amen.
Now this is what you have to understand as a believer. These are just types and shadows.
Right.
Yeshua in type and shadow is a high priest.
Right.
Not a physical one on earth like a Levite. Right. But in metaphor, he's a high priest.
Right.
The other metaphor is that he's also the lamb or sacrificial animal.
Right.
He's our bull, he's our ram, he's become our goat, taking on our sin, Yom Kippur goat. He's even the pigeon and turtle dove. He's even the fine sifted flour of the grain offering. He's all five of the Levitical offerings from Leviticus 1 all the way into details of chapter 7, to be honest. He's all of that because they're all types and shadow of what he came to do.
Right.
Now this is what you have to see, verse 21. We also have a Kohen Gadol, a high priest over God's household. So not only does his blood represent the blood of the animal, but he himself is also the high priest that offers the blood. What he's telling you is Yeshua offered his own life. He's the lamb and the priest in one person. Normally, a priest would get a lamb separate from him. Just like you and I would bring a lamb separate from us. We have to lay our lamb down because it represents laying our life down. Why do you think the Bible calls you a living sacrifice? You lay your life down as a living sacrifice. The animal represents you.
Amen. Yes.
Think about it. At the end of the week, you get a paycheck or 2 weeks. Or the month, that check represents your blood, sweat, and tears.
Amen.
And it's money. In those days, it wasn't always money. They brought the animal. That was the monetary value. So the value of that lamb was the value of your life.
Right.
So you laid the value of your life down. Well, Yeshua laid the value of his life down for you.
Amen.
To bring you value again.
Yes.
He paid a price that you couldn't pay. He paid a debt I did not owe. I owe a debt I could not pay. I needed someone to wash my sins away. Oh, but now I sing a brand new song. Amazing grace. My Yeshua paid a debt that I could never pay. And then we would sing. So I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. He gets sweeter and sweeter as the day goes by. Oh, what a love between my Lord and I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. Thank you, choir. You sound amazing. Great audition. No. So now we have this image in our mind. Yeshua is our high priest. Yeshua fulfills the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur. Yeshua is the lamb or the sacrificial animal that's laid down. He's our goat, our bull. Anything that represents our rebellion, he paid the price. He gives us access to the Holy of Holies, not on earth, but the original one that the tabernacle was a blueprint or model of, and that's heaven. So how do we get to the Father? Through Yeshua. Mm-hmm. How did Israel get atonement? Through the high priest. Mm-hmm. It's teaching you that the Old Testament foundation is the New Testament revelation.
Yes.
So that you can't have a revelation if you don't have a foundation. Amen. So people that say, well, we don't read the Old Testament anymore, or the Old Testament, guess what? You're missing the revelation of the New.
Right.
Because the New did not come to outdo the Old or do away with, it came to build upon, to make a fuller understanding of what was taught by Moses, what was taught by the prophets like Isaiah, Jeremiah. Everything the prophets said was fulfilled in Yeshua, but should continue to be fulfilled and taught through us today.
Amen.
There is nothing that God's ever said that he said, oh, I shouldn't have said that.
Right.
So, extract that from the book. Get the editor out. Take that out of the book before it gets published. No, it's all in the book. don't add or take away. It's all there. Every jot and tittle is being fulfilled in Messiah. Look at verse 22. This is what he wants from us. Yeshua is doing his work to get us to go beyond the veil for this reason. So we can draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith. Watch this. The high priest would go beyond the veil. What would he sprinkle? The blood of the animal 7 times. So instead of sprinkling the ark cover or the mercy seat or the ark of the covenant, he's now sprinkling our what?
Hearts.
What is the ark of covenant picture of? This treasure chest is our heart. Where your heart is, or where your treasure is, that's where your heart is. What did they hide inside the ark? The hidden manna, the rod that budded, and the tablets of the 10 words, and the covenant or the Torah was put in there. What does God promise in the new covenant he's going to put in our hearts? His Torah, his covenant, his commandments. Our rod's going to bud with fruitfulness from the fruit of the Spirit. And guess what? We're going to have manna from heaven called revelation. The ark contains his word just like our heart. Your word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against God. So what would they do? Against the tabernacle of ark of testimony, we sprinkle the blood to be a witness. That blood was sprinkled for us. It sprinkles our heart. And what does it do to our heart? It says, we come with a true heart and full assurance of faith, with our heart sprinkled clean from an evil conscience. And what happens to our bodies? We're washed with pure water, a picture of the priesthood. Let us hold fast the unwavering confession of hope, for he who promised is what?
Faithful.
Now this is where we get to the stir me up, Lord. Hebrews 10:24, it says, let us consider how to what? Stir one another up to love and good deeds. Ahava and mitzvot. Love and good deeds. And do not neglect our own meetings, our gathering together, King James says. What did the portion talk about? Being gathered together, assembled together by Moses. Now we're assembled together by Yeshua. Do not neglect our assemblies, as is the habit of some, but encourage one another. Why do we gather together? To encourage one another. And all the more so as you see the day approaching. The day of who? The day of Messiah. The day of the Lord coming closer. And the last passage I want to read for you, encourage you with, is 2 Timothy 1:6-7. Excuse me, 2 Timothy 1:6-7. It says, therefore, I remind you to what? Stir up. The Greek actually means to rekindle the fire of the gift of God. Some versions say fan the flame. But it means when the embers burning out, you got to stir it up. You got to get the fire going again. Rekindle is the actual translation of the Greek. What do we do on Shabbat? We kindle lights, right? On Friday night. Well, we need to rekindle. Yeah. Our fire is going out for Shabbat. We need to rekindle our fire on the Shabbat. And the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. Who is this talking? It's Paul, who imparted his spirit in Timothy. For God has not given you a spirit of what?
Fear
or timidity, but of power and of love and a sound mind. Some versions say self-discipline. Sorry, we changed that slide there. So power, love, and a sound mind instead of the spirit of fear. 5 things I want you to fill in today. It looks like 4 and another 4, but it should be 5 on there. Number 1, Hashem, that should say stirs us. Hashem stirs us up with a what? Willing and wise heart and a generous spirit. How does he stir us up? He stirs us up with a willing and wise heart and a generous spirit. So that's number 1 what he does. Number 2, Hashem, or the Lord, stirs us up to build his house and stir up his people. So as we build the house and we encourage people in the house, we stir people up. Our purpose is not just to settle and just to sit, because we weren't saved to sit. We were saved to serve. We serve one another. We encourage one another. We pour our life into our service to God. We build his house and we stir up his people. Number 3, Hashem uses leaders to stir up faith and rekindle our fire and overcome our fears. God uses leaders to stir up our faith, rekindle our fire, and overcome our fears. Because he says, I don't want you to have a spirit of fear, power, love, and a sound mind. And Number four, Hashem stirs us up to encourage one another in love and in good works. How do we encourage people? We show each other love, and we do things that are good. In fact, what we don't want is for people to come with hate, jealousy, animosity, shortness of tone, shortness of, you know, when someone is short with you, I'm trying to, what's that? To be very curt with you, but you know, when someone's very short with you or curt with you, they just don't really talk too much. They say, how are you doing? I'm fine. That's not what Shabbat's about. If someone asks you how you're doing, tell them how you're doing, even if it means I need prayer. So we stir each other up to encourage one another and to love and good works. And then last, Hashem stirs us up as we draw near with a true heart that is sprinkled and made clean by the blood of Messiah.
Praise God.
I believe if we will allow ourselves to be stirred up, we will have something in us to stir someone else up. Mm-hmm. The question is, are you stirred up today? Mm. Have you allowed your boiling water to become lukewarm? Has someone accidentally turned the flame in the wrong direction and it's gone off and you didn't know about it? Maybe you thought the flame was burning and it's nothing but gas going. Well, that's a possible explosion, so be careful. Maybe you said it's Shabbat, I'm not supposed to kindle fire on Shabbat. Well, then before sundown, leave it burning all night long on a low burner or a warmer and keep that food warm. That's what Jews do that are Orthodox. They just keep a nice little warmer burning all the way from before sundown to after to make sure the food stays warm. And they actually do it all night long to the next day for Shabbat so they can just rewarm food in a simple way. Isn't that funny how we can almost like try to maneuver things so we can fulfill God's greater purpose instead of just man's laws? And so it's important that when we keep Shabbat, it's not legalistic. It's not just limited to, you know, our expression, but it's all about community. And I really believe that God wants us to stir each other up to good works. Amen. Do you receive this message today?
Yes.
Would you stand to your feet? I'm going to bless you with number 624 through 26, knowing that this week's going to be a full week of learning about the garments, the breastplate, the signet seal, the priest or the Kohen. We're going to be consecrated or sanctify us as set apart. We're going to learn about the incense. And next week's message I'm going to teach about on the Sabbath is consecrated and committed. That's what we're going to become here. Consecrated and committed. Amen?
Amen.
Would you stretch your hands towards heaven for the blessing today? Yivarechach Adonai v'yishmarecha. Ya'er Adonai p'nav elecha vihuneka. Yisa Adonai p'nav elecha ve'asem lecha shalom. Amen. May the Lord Adonai bless and keep you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you, be gracious to you with his favor. May the Lord also lift up his countenance upon you and show you his peace and establish it for you, your children, and your children's children for his namesake and love today. May you, through Yeshua, the Messiah, be blessed today and every day. The rest of your week would be the best of your week, that you would just take this word of Shabbat, this word of rest, this word of being stirred up today into all that you say and do to touch someone else's life. In Yeshua's name we pray. Amen. God bless you.
Thank you.